I thought it would be good to start at the beginning.
Oh, how predictable.
The very beginning, where you were born, where you grew up.
Much of that I don't remember. I know, but I was born on we lived on the family farm near Higginsville, Ontario at the time, and went to the nearest hospital, which was in Hamilton, and moved to St. Catharines when I was about four or so. I had never been athletic. I never could play hockey. I skated on my ankles, which for a young Canadian kid, that's automatically like the hugest curse a young boy could have. It was horrible coming into high school once I got interested in rock bands and all that and started to grow my hair a little over my ears and wear bell bottoms and all that stuff. The taunting in the hallways and even physical abuse out in the smoking area and the constant misfit sense for any kid, especially a sensitive one, just wears you down. So that's why drumming became an instrument of self-esteem for me. In the summer of 74, I was working behind the parts counter for my dad at the farm equipment dealers, and this white Corvette pulled up.
A white Corvette doesn't pull up in the farm equipment dealership that often. They came and asked if they could talk to Neil and take him out to lunch, and I could tell as Neil came back the rest of the afternoon that he was really troubled with something. He told me then that these guys were the managers of Rush, and they wanted Neil to come over and audition, and he said, "I don't know what to do, Dad." And I said, "Well, two things. First of all, we'll talk it over with your mother. But secondly, as far as I'm concerned, this is your passion. This is all you have wanted all your life." And I said, "I guess there'll always be a parts department here, so I think you've got to go for it."
So I borrowed my mom's Pinto, so perfect, and loaded my drums into that and drove up to Ajax.
So this car pulls up with this kind of gangly guy with really kind of short hair. My first impression was that he was kind of goofy.
I remember thinking, God, he's not nearly cool enough to be in this band.
I had Rogers with two 18-inch bass drums and everything set up really high and kind of weird looking. And I was kind of weird looking.
And then he started playing them and he pounded the crap out of those drums. I mean, he played like Keith Moon and John Bonham at the same time. And
I was blown away. As soon as he started playing, he's playing these triplets and he was so good.
I think it's very common for musicians, especially in your early years, to feel that you totally blew it. And I had that feeling, I could have played better, I should have played better, all that stuff. But they picked me.
Welcome to the Friends of Dan Music Podcast. I'm Dan Miles. Back in 2012, when we lost Ronnie Montrose, I felt a compulsion to pay tribute to him since he'd been such a major part of my own musical journey. I felt that same way again in 2015 when Chris Squire died. In my mind, it was just too big an event to let pass without comment. Now, here in early 2020, I'm feeling that same impulse upon the news of the loss of Neil Peart. Rush has always been a huge presence in my life, both musically and culturally. And of course, Neil was an essential component of that equation. I knew many of my friends would be feeling the same way, so I reached out to several of them to create this tribute, which quite honestly is more about serving as an outlet for our personal thoughts and feelings than any serious contribution to the man's legacy, which is quite secure at this point. Not only was Neil an upper echelon elite drummer, but he was also an upper echelon elite lyricist. How often does that happen? By my count, exactly once. There was never going to be another Neil, just as there's never going to be another Rush. Both were one of a kind. Before we start bringing out the guests, there's something I want to briefly touch on regarding pronunciation. Back in the 1960s, a young, up-and-coming English musician named David Jones had to change his name upon the arrival of Davy Jones and the Monkees. He ended up calling himself David Bowie, but over time, so many people mispronounced it as Bowie that eventually he just stopped correcting them and started pronouncing it that way himself. Wasn't his real name anyway, so he probably figured, what difference did it make? You'll also hear the occasional David Bowie thrown into the mix, but I doubt he really cared, as long as the checks cleared. Similarly, for years, my friends and I all said Bachman-Turner Overdrive. Apparently, we were supposed to be saying Bachman-Turner Overdrive. Ace Frehley or Ace Frehley, yet another example. Rickenbacker, Rickenbacker, and the list goes on. To me, the granddaddy of them all is duct tape, which has been misidentified so frequently as duct tape that, as with David Bowie, 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 eventually the manufacturers just gave up and started labeling it duct tape and started putting pictures of ducks on the packaging, even though it made absolutely no sense. All this to say that the man we're honoring today was in a similar boat. To many of his fans, including some of the ones we're about to hear from, he's always been Neil Peart. Just as with the other examples I've given, at some point, the band stopped bothering to correct people, but they were always aware of it, as demonstrated by moments like this.
I told you not to eat Mr. Peart's sandwich.
It's just Peart.
You sure that it's not Peart?
I think he would know.
Are you sure? Because we're pretty big fans.
I don't know that anyone actually calls him Peart, but the notion that a Rush fan would presume to know more about the band than the band members themselves feels strangely on point, I'm sorry to say. But for practical purposes, Peart and Peart are going to be interchangeable throughout this presentation, simply because I also didn't want to correct anybody either. I just wanted to get on with it. Ironically, with all the attention given to Neil's last name, you don't really hear much about their bass player's unusual first name. For those of you who don't know, his name is actually Gary, but his mother spoke with such a thick Polish accent that when she said Gary, it came out more like Getty. So hearing that, his friends at school just innocently assumed his name was Getty, and it stuck to him like duct tape. So in conclusion, whether you're in the Neil Peart, YYZ, La Villa Strangiato camp, or the Neil Peart, YYZ, La Villa Strangiato camp, all are welcome as we pay tribute to what really matters, the awesome music of Rush.
Spirit is lingering.
God, 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 I think you got something here.
What a bunch of crap.
Crap, yes, but sometimes people love crap. Kugle, what do you think? You like it?
It doesn't suck so bad this time, Papa. No, no.
See, we got something.
Well, my first guest will be a very familiar one to longtime listeners of the show. Back in 2015, we did a roundtable discussion about the R40 tour, which we released as a joint production. I titled my version of it, A Farewell to Rush? Unfortunately, some of the questions we posed at the time have now been definitively answered, but it seems like a logical place to start this discussion, so let's welcome back to the show our longtime compatriot, Mr. Tom Bowers.
Hello, Daniel. How are you this evening?
I'm doing quite well. Now, we have an interesting little sideline to start out with in that the day we both heard about Neil's passing, we actually attended a concert together here in Phoenix that very same evening. And there was a period of time before I started engineering the show when Tom was doing it for me. Do you remember the episode we did with Scott Sherrard where, you know, you told both of us after we were done doing the show that Prince had died?
Yes. Was I smart enough to wait until the show was done before I said anything, or did I cast a pall over the proceedings by announcing it up front?
No, we talked about it before we started, and it was a rumor at the time, but unconfirmed rumor, and then you told us about it at the end. You waited.
Yeah.
So the reason I bring that up is I was sort of, you know, chatting with Lyle Workman, and I mentioned, that's too bad about Robin Williams, and he goes, what? And I realized I was the guy who told Lyle Workman that Robin Williams had died. So I did not want to be the guy to tell Tom Bowers that Neil Peart had died. So
Yeah. But it's funny. I was on my way to Phoenix when the news came down.
Yeah.
I was, it's about a 6-hour drive from Los Angeles here. And my girlfriend and I were taking turns driving in shifts. And I had just come off of my shift. So I was, you know, firing up the Intertron to see what was going on in the world, and boom, it hit me right then. And almost immediately I started receiving texts and IMs saying, you know, are you okay? Did you hear? Et cetera, et cetera. And most of them were, you know, really incredibly sweet and concerned, which I thought was nice.
The concert we saw was Styx, and Styx and Rush are, you know, maybe with Pink Floyd thrown in there, probably your top two bands. And I knew that it would be a big deal to you. And I also knew you were traveling and I didn't know your internet access. So I very tentatively, you know, sort of tagged a message with, it's too bad about Neil, huh? Hoping that you were going to say what you did, which is, yeah, like you already knew. I just didn't want you to always go, oh, yeah, Dan Miles was the guy who told me about one of my heroes passing away. So
yeah, I found out through the news, through the, you know, seeing people post about it rather than anyone telling me directly about it in an offhand kind of way. Everyone who approached me about it approached me very, very conscientiously and gently about it, which I really appreciated. Well, I don't know if it was necessary, but it was funny. We got to the concert in Phoenix and we were meeting up with friends, of course, not just you, but lots of other Styx folks were touching base with. And people would just come up to me and say, tough day, huh? And I knew exactly what they meant. And they knew that I knew. And it was one of those what is understood doesn't need to be discussed kind of things.
In preparation for this, you know, I went back and listened to the roundtable that we did. And, you know, we speculated about the future of the band. And one of the things we wondered was, is Rush just done? Or are they going to maybe, although they'll still tour, but instead of being so extensive, they'll just hit the big cities? Or were they going to just continue to, you know, record and release music, but just not tour in support of it, you know? And so nobody really knew at the time. Of course, now we know that that was it. Last tour, no more music forthcoming unless they have something in the vault. But the official announcement was very specific about Neil's 3.5-year battle with cancer. And of course, that tour was 4 years plus ago. So are you also drawing the conclusion that I am, that during that tour, Neil was not aware of this diagnosis?
I think it would be unseemly to speculate about it, but I'm willing to take everyone at their word that this wasn't one of the factors that involved his initial retirement. Although, you know, they did a very good job of keeping the whole thing under wraps. Even when he died, there wasn't any news about that until 3 days later. Mm-hmm. So it's possible that it predates the date that's being said, but I hope not.
Yeah.
I certainly hope that there was some time in between him retiring from, you know, the rigors of the road and all of that, and being able to spend more time focusing on his family and his home life and things that were important to him, in between that happening and receiving a diagnosis and then having to deal with all of that. I certainly hope there was a nice oasis of tranquility in between.
I guess we'll never know for sure. I think one reason they were able to keep it quiet was I think after that tour was over, Rush was kind of off everybody's radar in the sense of the media anyways. Nobody was like stalking them for quotes or anything because they had done this farewell tour. And the other thing I'll say is my own father retired from his job and a couple weeks later got a terminal diagnosis and, you know, a year and a half later was gone. So it's also possible that, you know, Neil did the tour without any knowledge of this, was all jazzed about his retirement, and maybe I'll be a screenwriter or maybe I'll try some other musical. Who knows what he was planning to do? And then had this news dropped on him, and, you know, it's possible it could have gone either way. Sometimes we just kind of know there's something wrong with us too, and he might have maybe not wanted to go to the doctor to find out what it was. Let me not let down my fans and my bandmates. It's all speculation at this point. I'm just very thankful that tour happened, that I have a DVD of it, that we had that roundtable discussion about it, and we all enjoyed it, and they got to do a farewell tour and wave goodbye, and you know, Neil got to come down and give a rare hug to the band members and wave to the fans, and all that happened.
Like the lady says, you only regret the shows you miss, and I was there for their last show here in Los Angeles, and I am so glad I didn't miss that.
And by last show, literally the last show. Not just the last show of the tour, but the last time they ever performed.
Yeah.
Well, now let's transition to some happier thoughts and, you know, speak about your own personal Rush fandom and how you discovered the band and what drew you to them. And, you know, talk about some happier memories of Neil and what will stay with you now.
Wow. Well, let's see. My Rush fandom goes back to the late 80s. I had older friends who had older brothers who were very into them throughout the 80s. And so I was aware of them, and I was aware of them being on MTV in the age of Tom Sawyer and Red Barchetta and whatnot. But I didn't get hooked until a friend of mine played me the Grace Under Pressure tour video. And I really hooked on to Distant Early Warning. That was the song that that grabbed me. So I went out and bought Grace Under Pressure. A couple of years later, the Show of Hands live album came out, and everything started snowballing from then. I was big into live albums at the time. It was sort of like buying a greatest hits and then deciding which ones you like and going that way. Only I thought that the live thing was a different, you know, kind of way to experience that. Mm-hmm. So I was very much hooked on the 80s Rush before I went back and discovered the 70s Rush. But once I did, it was one of those things that I've heard it described as sympathetic vibrations, that there's just something about the tenor of what an artist puts out into the world that, not to get all woo-woo about it, but that, you know, resonates with you on a like a spiritual level. And that's, there are some bands that, you know, I hear like one song that I love, one record that I love, or they have me for a while and then they lose me, or they get me back later, or it kind of goes back and forth in waves. But there are a handful of artists who just have me. Every note and every beat and every word, they have me, and Rush is one of those bands. So my first new Rush album was Presto. Still probably my favorite album, not what I would consider objectively their best, but has a special place in my heart because this band that I had, you know, devoured the dozen records they'd put out already and was so eager for new material. And here's this new record, and it was incredibly fulfilling and satisfying for me to hear it for the first time. And that was my senior year in high school. I went to New York City for the first time that winter, and I brought that record with me. And so it'll always remind me of my first trip to New York. There's a lot of great memories attached to that record. There's a drum fill in the second and third choruses of The Pass. And it's so simple. It's not like a crazy out of left field kind of drum fill. It's a pretty standard pop rock thing. But it's after the line, all of us get lost in the darkness, dreamers steer by the stars. And then there's this particular drum fill that always just struck me as exactly the right thing and exactly the right moment, and enhances what's being said there so well and lifts the thing. And there's a moment in the video for The Pass where it doesn't show that fill, but it shows Neil playing on the third chorus just before that fill comes up. And the look on his face is so intense and emotional. And it's like, this is probably at the end of a long video shoot. We've been miming to this song all day, you know, and he's still got that grit and that concentration and focus. But you can also tell he's thinking about the words, and he's, if not genuinely moved in the moment, doing a very good job of, a facsimile of that. And it just gets me right in the heart every time. And now, even a little bit more, even though that song is not about this particular kind of grief, it's definitely a song about processing grief. And that's kind of a big deal to me. So yeah, The Pass.
My friend Manning Bartlett, also his entry to Rush was Distant Early Warning. That's the track that roped him in. And it's interesting that you say, you know, seeing the Grace Under Pressure video, because seeing Rush is interesting too, because, you know, watching them do what they do and realizing that, you know, there are Taurus pedals on there and there are synthesizers within Getty's reach, and that Neil just can turn around and hit a bell or a wind chime, and you really have an appreciation for the craft and artistry of what they do. So hearing them is interesting because they have such a unique sound. And then seeing them is also, I think, important part of the fandom, because they toured for so long and they were together for so long. You get to see the evolution when they came out, you know, in the early 70s with long hair, it's just sort of like a power band. And then by R40, they're this, you know, seasoned unit with all this history. In every sense of the word, man.
That wonderful film that they showed before all the R40 shows, where the little animation that showed all their different looks and all their different phases and the different in jokes associated with them, and they sort of couched it as a travelogue. Mm-hmm. As they're on their way to the gig that night, they've gone through all of these phases, and now they're going to go through all of them again in reverse, as the R40 tour did, which was really clever and really cool. But that's the thing, is that they, you know, Rush, very much a people's band, you know, famously critically reviled up until the last 10 years or so. And they made their bones, like Dave Grohl said at the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame induction, by touring and touring and touring and touring and winning over their audience one member at a time in the most honest, straightforward way that you can possibly do it. So it totally makes sense that, I'll bet, if you ask, you know, a lot of the folks who you're talking to, and even just folks who are generally Rush fans, how did you get into the band? I'm thinking either a live gig or a live video is probably going to be one of the more prominent answers. one of the great ironies of all of this outpouring of emotion and sort of heartfelt tribute that people are making. And it's been wonderful to see on social media. I mean, the articles just keep coming of people saying, here's my, you know, memories of Neil. Here's my Rush experience. Here's what I got out of all of this. Here are, you know, all these archived interviews and archived videos that are popping up. And it's really heartening, and it helps, ironically, to take the edge off of this. It somehow, wading through all this doesn't feel like wallowing, but it really feels like it was all about his integrity, his worldview. And part of that whole ethos of his is that, you know, he would probably be a little bemused at the idea that all of these people seem to be taking this so personally. You know, it's going back to Limelight and all of that, his sort of ambivalence toward fame. He would probably find all this a little gauche, perhaps. But it really, you know, it's not like for me, like when Chris Squire died, I was incredibly sad, and what a great talent. And it was, you know, a sort of a signifier of my own mortality, as these things often are, and the world moving on and an era coming to an end, and all of that stuff was in there. But it wasn't as personal for me in the way that this is. This really is sort of like losing a surrogate dad in a way, someone who was a role model and someone who I learned life lessons from, even though I never met them. It's bigger than just, wow, he could really play the drums, you know? But speaking of drums, here is the other drum moment that I'm throwing out, because I feel like it probably won't get mentioned, but I think it deserves some, which is, this is a solo moment that the evolution of Neil's drum solos over the course of the band's life is really interesting, and kind of where they were placed in the set and how they used to come out of a song and then back into the song. And then after a while, they had their own space to just be a complete solo. And then they kind of went back into that later on, and there were multiple solos per night, but they were shorter than the big epic solo he used to do. The charting the course of that is really interesting. But towards the end, I think it was on the Clockwork Angels tour. There was a segment he used to do towards the end of the night called The Percussor. And it was all done on the electronic kit. And it was like water music. It's this very splashy sort of melodic, almost like a vibe xylophone thing, but it has a completely different pulse and a completely different approach to its phrasing than anything else he's done in his other solo things. You can sort of break down some of his more traditional beats and things like that, but this had its own character. And I love the idea that more than 30 years into the guy playing professionally and doing this sort of thing professionally, he was constantly still innovating and finding a new way to express himself on the instrument. So The Percussor is a favorite of mine.
Well, as always, Tom, thanks for coming on the show. I mean, it's never fun to talk about one of our heroes being gone, but I certainly thought of you first, just like when we did the R40. So it's great to have you on here to get this started off, and I'm sure we'll speak again soon.
Well, thank you very much for having me, and yes, I look forward to it.
Joining me now from Butler, Pennsylvania, we have a longtime friend of the show. You might have heard me mention his name in the past. He definitely contributed to the Carmine of Peace episode. Let's welcome professional drummer and drum instructor, Gino Fratto. Welcome, my friend.
Oh, thank you, Dan. It's awesome to talk to you, as always. I wish it was under happier circumstances.
Yeah, so do I. You know, Neil meant so much to so many of us, but, you know, yourself being a drummer and a person who teaches drums, I wanted to be sure and include you because I know you'll have some insights that those of us who, you know, pick up sticks and can't keep a beat or can't make our hands and feet work independently won't be able to relate to. You know, I feel like to really appreciate Charlie Parker, you need to be a saxophone player, and to really appreciate Alan Holdsworth, you need to be a guitar player. Would you agree that it's the same with Neil? To really appreciate how great he was, you have to try and do some of that stuff?
Possibly. I mean, he had so many fans that were non-musicians and were just lovers of fine music that it's hard to say.
When did you first become a fan of Rush?
81, I remember vividly buying Moving Pictures, the LP, and I sort of went backwards from that. I was 10 years old, and prior to that, it was all about AC/DC and Led Zeppelin, and Rush was a more sophisticated style of progressive music that my ears weren't really accustomed to. And, of course, I was hooked for life with Moving Pictures, and I just went and bought, you know, slowly bought all their previous material.
AC/DC, great drumming. You know, that's the beauty of simplicity. That's the beauty of just playing simple parts and recording them really well. And, of course, John Bonham is legendary. But I could see how somebody who is into the drumming of Bonham and AC/DC would hear Neil and Rush, and like you just, you know, eloquently said, sort of next level stuff, a little more complex, a little more complicated. But the cool thing about Rush was they never really lost their early roots as a rock band. You know, when they wanted to, the three of them could play, you know, bluesy, riffy stuff, and they could slip it into a prog tune, more so than I think any other prog act could.
Absolutely. And then they made it accessible to their loyal, very loyal fan base. It seems like there's a lot of, you'll find a lot of division in the music world with Rush, kind of like either love them or hate them sort of a thing, I guess. But one thing I did notice at seeing Rush over the years, several different times live, I did notice they seemed to garner more female fans as time went on.
Yeah.
Like back in the 80s, I remember like the vast majority being males. And then towards like the Time Machine tour and the 90s with the Roll the Bones tour, I started noticing more women. So that was cool.
Yeah, when you go to a lot of concerts with an act that's been around a long time, the two things you notice are that and also generations. You know, like if you go see Paul McCartney, you know, you'll see people who are original fans and their kids and their grandkids, and you know, you notice different generations. I remember I saw Jamie Glaser, he was playing with Anderson Ponte in Scottsdale, and you know, they look out at their audience and see these people with gray hair, and they go, yeah, what happened to our audience? I mean, we're still the same, right? You know, back in the 70s and the 80s when they were in their prime, you know, the people were, you know, in their 20s and 30s, and it's still the same people, but you know, I don't think it's a little bit of a shock for them to realize that their peer group is up in their, you know, 60s now.
Right. And like you were saying about Paul McCartney, I definitely see people bringing their kids and wives and girlfriends to the Rush shows, and everyone ends up loving it. Some of them might go into it not knowing what to expect, but they're in for quite a treat and a surprise, needless to say, once they see a Rush show.
Of course, you know, all the sort of factual accounts of Rush and their chronology and everything is well documented and everybody knows it. But, you know, from your own personal point of view, as you said, in 1981, Moving Pictures comes out. You start to follow them. You start to check them out. So did you see any latter-day shows?
So I only got to see them three times. Once was in the 80s. I think it was around the Presto era, if not the Presto tour itself. Then I saw Roll the Bones, and the final time I saw them was Time Machine, which I thought was the best overall, the best show I saw. I mean the sketches, that they played. I mean, just the overall lights, and of course, playing moving pictures in its entirety didn't hurt. Being a big fan of jazz fusion music through the original days of it, the early 70s on through till now, Rush still stand. I mean, they still absolutely stand alone in their own sound and style.
I will say that their music has stood the test of time, but I don't know if their fashion has.
Thankfully, they evolved with the times. Mm-hmm. I love how Getty referred to his one hairstyle. It was like some kind of a raccoon on his head.
Yeah.
During the mid-80s.
Yeah, in R40, they actually set in animated form, they set a raccoon on his head, and I think a raccoon tail was kind of what he meant. Had a little ponytail kind of thing.
Neil definitely always seemed to have a serious persona about him, which is what you would expect.
Yeah.
Alex absolutely, to me, seems to be like the most... gregarious one of the three. I mean, with his acceptance speech at the Hall of Fame, and just he's such a ham. He's so much. I find myself watching Alex live because he's so entertaining to watch.
Well, you wonder why they didn't make more use of the three voices. You know, Getty's the only one really with the microphone. Alex a little bit here and there, but I remember one of the live DVDs, he stepped up and I don't know what he was saying or doing, but they muted it on the DVD.
I remember I had the VHS tape of that, and I never did quite understand what that was about. It was some sort of political thing. I don't know.
I think it was just him trying to be funny in the moment and them deciding later that it wasn't as funny in retrospect as he thought it was at the time. So they made a joke out of it by, you know, making very obvious, you know, comments on screen about you're not going to hear what's being said right now.
I kind of like how they left like little mistakes in there. Like at one point, Alex hits a wrong note and the camera's on Getty, and Getty like just accusingly points in Alex's direction like, he did it, buddy.
Well, also, in the spot in 2112 where it gets really quiet and Getty comes in, and the meek shall inherit the earth. He knew they were being filmed, so Alex ran over and bumped the microphone right before Getty was supposed to sing that part. He's like, walked up and pushed the microphone so Getty couldn't do it. So, yeah, I mean, that's one thing about this band. I mean, they were just good buddies.
Getty and Alex are neighbors somewhere out in the outskirts of Toronto. They live like within a walking distance of each other, from what I've read.
Yeah, they've known each other since like the seventh grade. So
yeah,
they took a long journey together. It's funny that, you know, Neil was not on their first album, but he came in on their second album. And so they jokingly for 40 years always called him the new guy.
The new guy. Yeah, I know. I mean, I'd like to think Rush always had kind of a soft spot in their hearts for my area, like the Pittsburgh, Cleveland area. You know, we were kind of the first people in the States to take notice from some of the history I've read. I believe it was a disc jockey at a Cleveland radio station started playing Working Man. And apparently Working Man started catching on in Cleveland, and then it spread to Pittsburgh, and the rest is history, I guess you could say. Their first major gig, they opened up for Manfred Mann and Uriah Heep at the Pittsburgh Civic Arena.
It was like a tornado came and hit my life and swept it away. We had 2 weeks to prepare and to learn songs that I'd never heard before and to gel a little bit as much as we could. The first show was going to be in front of 11,000 people at Pittsburgh Civic Arena, opening for Manfred Mann and Uriah Heep.
We found that the biggest rock audience was Midwest. And we gave Rush the perfect audience to come into. It was a great rock audience, you know, and they loved their rock music. My immediate thoughts were, God, he can sing high, was my first thought. And how full it sounded, just a three-piece. And Rush came out and nailed it. It was obvious that they were gonna, you know, move up the ladder pretty quick.
Have you ever had a student come to you and want you to teach them something that Neil played? Because when I was a guitar teacher, people come to me with Joe Satriani or some difficult thing, I think just to see if I could do it, you know, let alone teach it to them. Has that ever happened to you with Neil?
I recently had a female student come in a few months ago, and I always like to ask people, one of my first questions, well, who are some of your favorite drummers? And she just, without blinking, said, Neil Peart. Here's a girl that never took a drum lesson before in her life, but again, you know, she was just one of those people that was obviously awestruck by Neil's magic, as so many of us were, and yeah.
That's great.
It happens.
I saw four in the mezzanine.
Yeah, I had three in the front row. Seven females at a Rush concert. Must be some kind of a world record.
Right, exactly.
And that's them saying it themselves.
I don't know who the writers were behind that clip, but that's so funny.
You know, as I said, I watched R40, and I've been to see Rush three times, and there's plenty of, you know, seven women are at a concert. That's an exaggeration. And it's not unique to Rush. I mean, they made jokes about that, and this is Spinal Tap. You know, your audience seems to be, you know, mostly male. I think it was true of a lot of hard rock bands. I mean, you know, it was dudes going to see Ted Nugent and dragging girlfriends along.
I think it was during the Snakes and Arrows tour. We were playing two nights in London. Both nights, they must have given the tickets away to some connected people or something. But there was a real ardent fan there and his girlfriend who was so miserable. Either sat like this or with their hands over ears for the whole thing. And the three of us are up there playing our hearts out as we do every night and wanting people to love it. Sure. You can't. No one ever, I think, gets over that kind of, you know, reaction right in the front of their faces. So I kind of wrote that if your girlfriend doesn't like us, please let her stay home or at least give her earplugs.
Right, thank you. Well, Gino, I appreciate you calling in and contributing to this. You know, it's as you said, it's a sad reason to have you on the show. Maybe we'll be able to have you on the show in the future for a different reason. But, you know, on behalf of all the people listening, you know, thanks for your thoughts.
Oh, you're more than welcome, Dan. Thanks so much for asking me to call in and take good care. I'll be listening to your podcast.
Hi, this is Christine Flagenstein from The Undertow of Chrissy on Deep Nuggets Radio, and I would like to offer some of my own personal thoughts about Neil Peart's passing and how he had an impact on me from not only from like a musical perspective, but also from a lyrical perspective. I found that from listening to Rush, the thing that got me into their music in the first place was listening to Neil Peart's lyrics, especially with Free Will, and a lot of the sentiments in that piece resonated with a lot of sort of existentialism themes and my own personal philosophy at the time, and that was like back in 2009, and I ended up exploring the rest of Rush's music as a result, and I was always impressed with Neil Peart's drumming techniques and how he played melodically. And then later on, I discovered that his drumming technique was also drawing in similar influences as Phil Collins, including Phil Collins himself. And it definitely made things kind of go full circle, because Rush ended up drawing in influences from one of my absolute favorite bands, Genesis. And I find that a lot of Neil Peart's lyrics definitely resonates with me. It helps get me through like a lot of sort of challenging stages in my life, and offering sort of a patient ear. It was kind of like there's just something about the way that Neil writes music that is universal and has a way of relating to people's experiences and any like trials, tribulations, and trying to maintain a realistic and rational perspective. And I know that he went through a lot of challenges in his life and got through it, but unfortunately in this case, he didn't quite make it through this challenge. But I'll definitely remember him for way that his music helped get me through a lot of challenges, between feeling marginalized as like a misfit, especially in subdivisions, and getting through sort of the rationalistic and scientific mindset and fighting against lack of rationalism in pieces like Natural Science and free will and to things like that. So I'd like to personally thank Neil for all of his hard work throughout the years, and definitely wish him well in the next stage and in life and being.